we go.
We did it.
We did it.
Look at us.
Y'all thought we were gone.
You guys thought we died.
Some of y'all thought we would never make it past episode 3. And let's be honest, we almost thought that too.
We almost did. Now, there was about 1.5 people who were like, where's episode 4 or whatever, like last Sunday? It's right here. Here it is. And it is a week late, but it's not for bad reason because, Dan, you got to go on like 74 trips.
Dude, I feel like September through December is just like travel apocalypse for me. I had an interesting last couple of weeks. Like I went about two weeks ago. I went to Omaha, Nebraska, to go visit with our old youth pastor, John Annan. I went to go visit him to go help him out with some technical things. And then, I came home like Saturday night and, we ended up going, that next Monday, I flew to Iowa with our lead team to go to a church planters conference and, you know, talk a little bit with some awesome churches from the Midwest about reaching more people for Jesus. It was really cool. And then I came back and then went up to the Bay Area for a couple days and then came back. And I'm here this week and then I go to San Diego next week. And we tried to do the podcast while I was in Iowa. I actually brought all my gear with me to do the podcast from the hotel. But Josh's lawnmower of a laptop finally gave out.
Yeah, dude, it was pretty tough. Not gonna lie. My laptop. Well, yeah. So you were gone. And then we also went through a new lease cycle at the church to get new laptops. So my old laptop was just, you know, like the meme of turning on your PS4 when it was like, that was the console. And it was just like an actual lawnmower, like very loud. That's how my laptop would get when I opened Chrome. So it's not good.
If you ever noticed why like Josh's sound always sounded so weird on this podcast, that's why.
Yeah, hopefully that's why. Hopefully it doesn't still sound like that, but we'll see.
You know, we're semi-professionals at podcasting.
Yeah, that's a discussion. Maybe we are, maybe we're not. But here's one thing I do know that we need. We need somebody, or maybe even a team of people, that want to figure out what the heck we need to talk about on all these things. Because here's how this goes. Everyone is like, oh my God, that podcast is so funny. I like watching it. I like listening to it. And then after like 30 seconds in the conversation, people are like, I wish you talked more about this. And then we're like, yeah, got it. Yeah, we'll do that. And then we walk away and then we're like, huh?
What are we talking about?
And literally maybe 7 minutes ago, we were recording this episode and then we just stalled out, like actually stalled out to a point where we couldn't just cut it and recover. It would have been like two different emotion, like it was like two different settings. Like we were talking and then we stalled out and then we both kind of got like,
we had recorded at least three different segments that definitely could not air.
Yeah, that was great. That was kind of the theme of it. It was like, oh dude, that reminds me of this story that I can't share. So I'm going to share like 2% of it.
Yeah.
It's not going to be funny. Hey, that's the name of the game.
That's showbiz, huh? Baby.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah.
The show must go on.
Dude, man. Speaking of show must go on and showbiz, our good friend Morgan had a baby.
Dude, it's showtime.
She had a baby.
Yeah, dude, that's Jack Ryan.
Jack Ryan.
I'm allowed to say it.
The baby's alive now. They can definitely say that.
Yeah, well, I mean, sometimes people are like protective of their freaking, you know, of their kin.
There's like 10 people watching this show.
That's true. 10 is generous as heck.
That's what the super heck? Generous.
Dude, look at that baby.
Morgan made a baby.
What happened?
Morgan made a baby. Yeah. How big were you as a baby, Josh?
Well, I'm not thinking of me as a baby. I'm thinking about like some of the dookies I've taken. You know what I mean? Like 9 pounds kind of light work, if you really think about it. I've never like pooped out of my, out of anything other than my butt. I guess in that way, that's kind of a feat in itself. But 9 pounds, yeah. Hey, I think I was probably 8 pounds.
I was like, I think I was like 8'6".
8'6" when you were born?
Yeah. 8'6".
Dang. So you've just been on the downhill since you were born.
I've been Benjamin Buttoning this thing. Dude, yeah, I am
awesome.
I stepped on the scale yesterday and I discovered, dude, I'm crushing it even more than I thought. Like
I'm now humble brag
a little bit, but like it's okay. I'll brag about it. I'm now down 37 pounds this year.
Nicely done, Diggins.
I ain't thickety Dan anymore.
You lose pounds.
I lose pounds. I also restarted the gym this week and okay. My least favorite time, like my favorite time, like if I'm just going by like time of day when I would love to go to the gym is like 3 o'clock in the afternoon would be like ideal for me because it'd be a great way to break up the day. Like I get tired of working, like answering too many questions. Like I'm peopled out. I need a little break. Be nice to put the headphones on, go to the gym, get on the treadmill, bang it out a little bit and like get going. And then, but the hard part is, you know, that's usually when all the high school students show up and the gym is just a madhouse. Mm-hmm. Also, I tried for a season of time going at like 9-10 o'clock at night, which isn't that packed, but the adrenaline would just shoot me up too bad and I'd be awake until 2 a.m. So I was like, well, that's not going to work either.
Yeah.
Can't go at like noon because lunch, but I've also never been a morning person. So I was like, well, I guess I'll just never go to the gym.
Guess so.
But Monday I woke up and was like, Monday morning I woke up and was like, you know what? I just got to do it. So I went to the gym at like 7 a.m., worked out yesterday at like 7:15 a.m. This morning, I didn't hit the gym this morning because Mary had to go to work and needed the car, but I did. I walked to Starbucks and back from my place, so about a 32 minute walk.
Nice.
Man, I'm just like, I'm feeling it. Like the habits are there, but I'll also say the gym, one of the things, the reasons why I don't like going during school season is kids are cringe.
Yeah, dude. They're like, kind of the worst.
Dude, like the amount of people that I watch at the gym just trying to show off at any opportunity they get. Like, and I'm not there for that. Like, I'm nothing to write home about. Like, and also, like, I who am I trying to impress? I got a wife. I love her. I've already impressed her. So, there like,
job complete.
Yeah, exactly. I've arrived. But so you watch these kids and they're like, oh yeah, look at me lift this. Let me check this out. Or, you know,
hey, yo bro, take a picture of me. Hey, yo bro, I'm making a TikTok. Dude, Does this look good? Does this make my lats look big? Am I huge?
I love that GB3 finally started posting signs everywhere that say, if you take photos or videos in our gym, we'll take your membership away.
Yeah, bro. If you take pictures or videos of yourself ever,
That's cringe.
If you're not posing with another human being in a picture because you want to memorialize the moment of what you're doing together, cringe.
Yeah, the whole concept of the selfie is kind of cringe.
If you're a person who has ever posted a photo dump, if you'd even call it this because it's all the same thing, where you are pretty much in the same spot, solo, just in different like poses in the same spot and cringe. You post them. Come on. What are you doing? What are you doing, bro?
Part of me thinks the whole concept of the photo dump is cringe. I'm like, just post what you want, you know?
It's true. That's like OG Instagram days though, when people actually were just like, look at what I'm looking at, you know? Or like people used to post screenshots on Instagram as like posts that, so funny.
I don't get it, man.
Funny. Now it's all curated.
You know what's been cool is like, so I've been off of the app, the Instagram app, since Houseboats. And it's mostly like the thing I miss, like I don't see in a lot of what people are going. So I feel like I'm like missing a little bit of what's going on in people's lives sometimes. Like, or I'll find out news like way late, which I don't think it's a problem because we don't need to know everything at all times. Like,
it's true.
I think we've
sometimes you're better off.
Yeah. Sometimes I'm better off not, you know, having to know, like, I don't think our souls and our bodies and our minds were meant to carry everything that we carry in this digital age.
It's true.
And I think that's where a lot of the anxiety that, like, people, young people and people of this generation carry.
It's true.
When they ask, why do young people have so much anxiety? Well, it's because we know everything that's happening with everybody at all times. Like, I don't think we were meant to know. Like, of course it's going to feel overwhelming. Like, look at all the things these people have that I don't have. Look at all the conflict in every single corner of the world. Like, everything is dark everywhere. And, like, you have to be outraged and, like, emotionally wrecked by everything happening bad to anyone everywhere. And it's like,
yeah, that's kind of the thing that, like, is lame is, the influence on social media for what your reaction ought to be, you know, where people, I mean, the clear and obvious case was like 2020, but even with other things, it's like you go into a comment section and you see people with different reactions. And then the comments under each of those comments are like people berating that person for having that reaction, or like, you should be this, you should feel this way instead. It's like, I would actually be better off if I didn't even know this and didn't feel any way about this at all. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because now I have to sit here feeling bad about how I reacted.
Yeah. Or you just, like, get driven further into that, like, the way that you were thinking before, you just get further into it because you're, like, defending it so much.
You get this.
Whereas, well, like, it probably didn't matter in the first place.
It's this well-solidified echo chamber.
Yeah.
And usually you follow people on social media that are, I would say 80 to 90% of the people you follow are going to be people that are like you.
Yeah. Dude, so in the last election, the 2020, or I guess, yeah, 2020.
Yeah, 2020.
I was following this dude who would probably, he fell in line with, like, what I, at least at the time, what I was thinking and believing politically. But he was definitely more, like, outspoken, I guess, and very on one side, clearly. And there, I had a moment where I was scrolling on my feed and I just saw, like, 8 things in a row from multiple people, but there was one from him and it was just so, like, it seemed so out of touch, but it was so, like, right leaning, you know? Which I was like, I think from a policy standpoint, I agree with what you're saying, but, like, I feel like you're so closed off, and what I'm just putting on my feed and, like, what I'm taking in, it's not allowing me to really, like, have nuance in my life. You know what I mean? Speaking to the echo chamber that you're talking about, like, I want to be the type of person that is capable of loving everybody. And if the stuff that I'm taking in is, like, everybody who thinks differently than us is bad, or, like, is dumb, or is racist, or is this, you know, I'm like, I don't want to hear that crap. So I just remove it.
It's the algorithm is tailored for radicalization, I think.
Yeah. 100%.
And, you know, we get asked this question. So it's wild. Okay. And I think this is the first time we've current events on this show a little bit, but, like, again, so this Sunday, because we're a week late, so by the time this airs, it'll have been a week since this happened. But there was a, I don't know if you saw, there was another assassination attempt on Sunday.
Yeah.
Which, on Trump.
Are you referencing the golf course?
I'm referencing the golf course.
Okay. So then this morning, which this isn't confirmed, but there was a, they found like a car bomb at one of his rallies, like today.
Oh, jeez.
Or something like that. So it's just, it's all happening. But back to the golf course thing, because that's actually current.
Yeah. So, yeah. So I'll start with, that's the one I saw, is on Sunday. Somebody, somebody tried to go after Trump again and assassinate him, which, okay, we should all be able to agree, like, however political you are, whatever side you lean, or if you don't care, we should all agree that assassination is bad.
Yes.
Like, I think it's that's values. Like a moral baseline that like killing people that you don't agree with is never a good idea.
Yeah. And the politically thing or the politically speaking, the odd thing is when you see people who have a hard time admitting that because it can hinder their political, aspirations or whatever. Like they can't come out and say like, hey, that was bad. Or I don't think Trump should get shot at because that's like counter to what they're doing. But I did see, there's a news anchor who I think is formerly CNN, might still be CNN, Chris Cuomo. He did like this whole like 3-minute thing where he like apologized for his rhetoric against Trump. He didn't apologize for the criticism because he's like, I believe what I was saying was true. But like, you know, we're so divisive. No one deserves to do that. He was like, if I was Trump and I got shot in the ear, I would not be on the campaign trail. You would never see me leave my house. like he is courageous and he's going out there and he's doing this, but like nobody deserves to be afraid for their life and to have numerous attempts. They don't deserve to have one attempt. They definitely don't deserve to have numerous attempts on their life. This is crazy. So it's like you get both sides. Like there's people who will condemn it and there's people who will like forego their political leanings to be like, but this is what's right. This is moral. And we can all agree here, right? Like let's find some common ground. But then you get people, and this is for both sides. It's not just this situation. But then there's people on both sides who like they can't even bring themselves to do. It's like it's almost like you're too prideful to admit that was wrong, you know, or we do have common ground here.
Yeah. And you know, the wild thing is, you know, there's a climate on both sides politically that's been created this way.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's everybody wants to make everything so extreme.
Mm-hmm.
So you have both sides of a presidential campaign, both sides saying every chance they get that if the other person is elected, it is the end of our country as we know it.
I know. It's so funny.
It is. Yeah. Both sides is new like thing this year. Like in everything you see is save democracy.
Yeah.
If Trump wins, democracy is over. And then you have Trump saying, If the Democrats win, this may be the last election we have in the U.S. because the country's just going to be gone. I'm like, what?
Yeah. What? How are we proposing that this happens?
Yeah. What do you think is going to happen? Like, are you saying like if Harris wins, we're going to burn it down, or she's going to burn it down?
Yeah.
So it's but again, there's this culture of radicalism, and there's this culture of. Because information is so easy to get at now.
Yeah.
Like, I can find anything to support what I'm feeling. And then the reels are going to start pointing me towards things that support this platform.
True.
And show me the most extreme examples of caricatures of these. Because we don't even get to people as people anymore. They're just caricatures. It's the left, the right. And there's no nuance anymore.
Yeah.
Like, it's not okay to say, hey, I'm a conservative, but I agree with what this person on the left side of the aisle said. Mm-hmm. Or, hey, I'm a liberal, but Trump makes a good point about this. I think he's wrong about these other things, but he makes a good point about this. Like, nobody wants to admit those things.
Yeah.
And we'll watch our government stall out at times because we can't give the other side a win.
Yeah, like, so it's funny. So they had that debate, like, I guess at this point it was a couple weeks ago. But they had the presidential debate, and I didn't watch the whole thing, but I watched part of it. And going into it, I was like, dude, Kamala and Joe, they don't talk. And when they do talk, it's, like, never good. And I was like, in the last debate, Trump was very, reserved. Like he wasn't attacking. He wasn't this or that. So I kind of expected it to go like that. I was expecting it to be like Trump was going to not be on the attack, and Kamala was going to just try to attack him. But it was actually, I mean, it wasn't completely the opposite, but she overperformed in my head. Like, you know, and everyone's like, you know, well, it was a 3-on-1, the moderators were against Trump. And I was like, I see parts of that too. But like in my head, I was like, I think she talked a lot more about policy specifically than I thought she would. I don't necessarily agree with either of their policies for like 100%, but like, I thought she overperformed, and that type of admittance is like not shared with most people on the right. Same way with like people on the left, or here, you see what I'm doing. I'm even doing what you just said. I'm saying right and left, but like people who would call themselves liberal, people who would call themselves conservatives, like Democrats today, they're like, the economy's great. What do you mean? And you're like, no, it's not. What do you mean? What do you mean, guy? Like, everything is more expensive. They're like, inflation, it didn't happen. It's great. And you're like, okay, can you just
can you admit that you got some things wrong?
Yeah, can you just be honest?
Yeah. Like, is there,
but that doesn't exist. You know what I mean? And going back to what you said, though, about like kids being online and they know everything, they see everything, and they're anxious. They don't know how to process this stuff. Like, to the point about the algorithm, like, that stuff's not just going to go away unless you fight for it to be a different way. Like, if you don't recognize what's happening on your feed and what is being curated for you, like, you will always be in this cycle of anxiety and just fear of, like, of the way the world is, because you're carrying too much. You have to decide, one, I either want my feed to be different by not consuming certain things, or I have to do what you did, Dan, and I have to just like remove myself from it, because I have to fight for what I want. It's not just going to happen for me.
Yeah. And aside from the obvious things of, it's just such a big time waster, like, and it's hard because like, even, you know, I've been accessing Instagram like through the browser, through my computer, so I can keep up with people and not be bombarded with reels. But like, it's invaded every facet of our social media. Like, I think there's a reason why like Instagram now looks like Facebook, now looks like TikTok. Well, TikTok started, but now looks like YouTube. Like, you, everything has reels. Mm-hmm. Like, it's because it works. It's because it's addictive.
Yep.
Like, I almost, the hard thing is, I've almost deleted YouTube at this point, which sucks because I use YouTube a lot for like, I love watching just videos. But I woke up this morning at like, I woke up at almost 8. I woke up at 7:45 at 8 o'clock. I took my walk to Starbucks, took my walk back. It's a beautiful morning out. I mean, it's hotter than I want it to be, but it's a beautiful morning out. And I'm scrolling reels or YouTube shorts the whole time. And I'm like, what am I doing?
Yeah.
Like, I'm wasting now. And YouTube shorts is different because for me, I was discovering that Instagram and YouTube, like, it was getting more mindless. Like, it would, that was where I was seeing all the radical positions. That was where I was getting way more political content than I wanted to, way more like just stuff I didn't want to see anymore.
Mm-hmm.
YouTube, it's all mindless. Like, yeah. I think YouTube this morning as I was scrolling showed me like 20 Simpsons and Family Guys clips, which is great, but I'm like, God, it's just brain rot.
Yeah.
And yet, like, they only do this because it works. So one of the things I saw at the gym yesterday morning, I was looking up at the TV, and because they got all this, and I'll say GB3 on the treadmills is the funniest place to watch TV. Because they have those little things you can plug headphones into that nobody uses because we all have AirPods. But you have, there's always like four channels running. It's always like Good Morning America, ABC News, ESPN, Fox News, and CNN. Yep. And I always laugh at Fox News and CNN being right next to each other in the gym.
Yeah.
Because you could look up and you were seeing the exact same story being told two different ways.
It's so funny.
It's hilarious. Like, and then this interesting thing happened. So on Good Morning America, I'm looking up at this feed, and I'm reading the closed captions, but they had Adam Mosseri on yesterday morning, he's the head of Instagram. So he's the creator of Instagram. He works for Meta now, like running Instagram still. And they've announced that they're introducing some major changes to like teenage accounts on Instagram. So it basically, I think if you're under 16 or 17, whatever, I can't remember what it is, your parents can go in and control what you see on Instagram. And they can restrict an account down to say, you can't message with strangers. You can't, I don't want any political content coming through, any of this. I don't want any, boobies coming through and stuff, which is, all stuff that...
Yeah, it's good. Yeah. Sign me up, bro.
Really?
Restrict the heck out of my Instagram. I don't want to see politics. I don't want to see... sports and bulldogs, bro.
If we can keep politics and boobies out of all of our feeds, the world would be a better place.
That's great. That's the way of life.
Yeah.
Actually.
But it's wild. That should be a whole, sermon series in youth.
Yeah.
Keep politics and boobies out of your feed.
No, straight up. That's rule 41.
Rule 41. We'll have to get to the We Go Pornography episode on here at some point.
Yeah, dude.
That won't be what we call it, but or it might be. We get clicks.
Yeah, that's true. Get rid of that crap. How about that? Yeah, dude, if I was president, outlaw.
For real. It's absurd. Yeah. But anyway, I'm watching them talk about this on Instagram. And it's funny the way, so they asked him a question you guys have faced a lot of lawsuits about child safety online. And he's like, well, we're not doing this because of the lawsuits. We're doing it because it's the right thing to do. I'm like, no, you're doing it because of the lawsuits.
Yeah, guy.
Yeah. Yeah. Sure I believe you. But so then I watch, and it's funny, they said it was exclusive with him. And then 10 minutes later, there was an exclusive with him on Fox. And they don't interview him on that one. They just basically go back through and they made their entire piece about how Instagram is a tool of the left for censorship. And I'm like, man, same story. We have a story about keeping kids safe online.
Yep.
Different views.
Yep.
That's cringe. It's true. So cringe.
It's cringe, but you know what's even more cringe? Falling for it every time.
Every time.
Every time, dude. Why are we going to news anchors or social media, TikTok? Why are we going to these places for answers?
They don't have them.
Or to dictate how we should feel. Yeah. What are we doing?
We don't want to think for ourselves.
Yeah, dude. God's word, baby. What does your life look like? And maybe you can actually answer this literally, Dan. What does your life look like now today when you put your, when you're going to God's word first and you're not going to Instagram and you're not going to the news app and you're not going here, you're not going there. How does that affect your day to day, the way that you feel, the way that you see the world, the way that you see others?
Anytime I start my day with anything other than the word of God, it takes me that much longer to find peace in my day.
Mm-hmm.
It's that simple. For me, the constant flood of information coming at me, trying to tell me how to think and what to feel and what to buy and how outraged I should be and how worried I should be and how scared I should be and everything in between, who I should hate, who I should love, who I should condemn, who I'm against, who I'm for.
Yeah.
Who I need to be comparing myself to because, oh God, these people graduated high school with me and they're going on worldwide cruises and they've got a house and they've got these kids and I have none of those. I don't got that kind of money. I'm in debt. I need to be comparing or I go and look and be like, oh man, I mean, at least I got it all together compared to these people who are posting all their club experiences and all their like just emptiness. Like, man, I'm so glad I'm not like that.
Yeah.
All of it, every single bit of it is just overwhelmingly over, like, it's overwhelming.
Yeah.
It's
too much.
It's overwhelming. It rots your mind. It rots my, and I sound like old man yelling at cloud right now, but no, it does. Like, if I am, there's a difference when you fill your mind with the word of God. There's a, my favorite passage of scripture, Colossians 3. I always go back to it no matter what. Like, I can always go back to Colossians 3, 2. Set your minds on above, not what is on the earth, for you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. If you have chosen to follow Jesus, you have a new life.
Yeah.
You have a life with him. And the things of the kingdom of God matter infinitely more than the bullshit of this world and the mess that I'm dealing with. And all of this, all the political, all the social, all the relational nonsense, all the things that society says I have to be, says I have to buy, says I have to act like. I don't have to carry that burden if I'm setting my minds on the things of the kingdom of God, because there's so much better. That burden is so much lighter. Like Jesus tells us in Matthew 11, my burden is light, my yoke is easy. What that means is that when I am walking with Jesus and I am walking at his pace, it is a manageable pace. It is a much calmer pace. It is a pace that I can walk along with. Like, he's not dragging me and I'm not like trying to pull him to my level. Like, walking at Jesus' pace gives me freedom, because there's freedom in the peace that he offers.
Yeah. 100%, dude. I'm teaching on, 1 Corinthians 15. And, there's this one verse in there. I think it's verse 48. I might be wrong. Might be 49. And it's referencing, this is Paul talking, and he's teaching about he's comparing like man, flesh, to dust, right? And like this is referenced throughout scripture. But there's like a man representing dust, but then there's also a spiritual man. And this is like our human flesh self and then our spiritual self. But the scripture says that the dust comes first. That is who we are, like, to our core. If we are not intentional to put on the spiritual self and to put on God's armor and to put on his righteousness, then we actually don't walk that way. And back to what we're talking about with this whole politics, Instagram crap that we're referencing is like, what are we going to do to put on his righteousness every day? What are we going to do to like intentionally choose that spiritual self and not just sit in our dusty selves? Like when we die, we wither away, we return to dust, we become the earth again. And the scripture says like, that is what we're going to be if we don't become something else. You know what I mean? We have to choose.
Our spirit has to grow.
Yeah. And that's like a muscle. You know what I mean? It takes time, but it's an intentional choice.
What are you nurturing your spirit with? What are you feeding your spirit with? Because if that is, like that scripture says, if that's all that lasts, I was reading it while you were there. It says, our verse 53, for our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies.
Yep. Perishable can't inherit the imperishable.
Yeah. Yeah, verse 50, our physical bodies could not inherit the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
So the more we're feeding our physical bodies, like meaning our flesh, like our own inclinations and desires, the more that we're feeding that and neglecting our spirit, we're just wasting time.
100%.
And we're carrying all of this burden and we're carrying all of this anxiety and stress. That's unnecessary.
Yeah.
Because
what
when you
feed, really yeah. matters, you yeah. know,
all that really matters is feeding your spirit.
Exactly.
And how do you feed your spirit? By following the will of God.
100%.
By walking with him, by developing your spiritual life, by spending time with him, by spending time with others, by pointing others toward Jesus so that they too can get out of this mess that they're walking in and this mindlessness that they're walking in, and they can walk in step with their own spiritual life, and they can develop a life with the Spirit of God.
Yeah, dude, that's like, to your point about when you start the day with the Word of God, when I don't do that, and I'm led by Instagram or think this, think that, feel that, this is what's happening, current events, you should be worried about this. Like, the first thing that goes out the door is compassion for me. You know what I mean? Like, when I start with God's Word and I'm others focused and I am like spiritually, I am like locked in, you know what I mean? Then all of a sudden the mission for that day is let's go pack heaven out. Like, I'm way more concerned about people knowing the Lord than I am anything else. But if I don't start that way, well, all of a sudden I'm thinking about things that don't matter. And when I'm thinking about things that don't matter, or I'm thinking about myself, well, all of a sudden I'm not concerned with what God's concerned about. And that is precisely not what He created me for, you know?
And it's even things that you enjoy that might be distracting you. Like
100%.
If I start my day not focused on the Word of God, but I start my day like focusing on how much the Giants suck this year. Like,
yep,
that's going to annoy me. That's going to annoy me all day. And I'm going to be thinking about that. Something that matters so little, something that's so fun, but matters so little, you know? And you know, like what happens, like when you just become a meaner person, anytime the Chargers lose, although Chargers are doing great this year for some reason.
It's true, dude. Chargers are pointing me right back to Jesus every week. I'm like, Jim Harbaugh, come on now.
Is he the third coming of Christ?
I wouldn't say that, but
good, because that'd be blasphemous.
Yeah, that'd be a little close there. But I do think God loves him.
This is my
also loves everybody. You know what I mean?
This is my first year like watching football, really. Yeah. I am
As a Charger fan, this is also my first year watching football because I don't know what the heck we were calling it before. I know what you all
been playing before, but it wasn't football. I had this great moment in the midst of all my traveling last week. So I was traveling during opening week, and I was traveling during the first Monday Night Football. I was in the Dallas airport for like 5 hours, and which sucks.
Yeah.
Although Pastor Scott has this weird, like somebody gave him this like lounge membership that like gets him into like airport lounges around the world. And so that was like the most surreal experience I had ever had. Like we got into this like weird private airport lounge. There were snacks. There was a whole jar of Dr. Pepper flavored jelly beans.
That's awesome.
Cause it was Texas. But also the Dallas airport just sucks cause it's so big and everything's always late and delayed. It's insane. But we went for dinner and we're like, oh, you know what? Monday Night Football is going to happen. Niners Jets. We should watch this.
We watched.
Because I'm a Niners fan and Pastor Dwayne is a Jets fan. I don't know why. He's never lived in New York, but he's like a Yankees and a Jets fan. I've never met like another living Jets fan.
Yeah, I think I've met one maybe, but they're rare for sure.
So we're sitting at dinner and we're like, oh, we get to watch this game when it comes on. And then we look and we're like, oh, DirecTV still had a blackout with Disney. Like they had a contract dispute. And so DirecTV had no ABC, no Disney Channel, no ESPN. Like it was all blacked out. And Monday Night Football is an ESPN thing. So we were like, oh, we can't watch this game. This sucks. So I have to pull out my ESPN Plus subscription and like redo another trial. We start watching this game in the airport and then we're boarding the flight and we see, hey, American Airlines lets you watch live TV on the flight. Like they have ways they show certain live things, including games. And I'm like, that's awesome. We can finish watching the game on the flight.
It's great.
So I pull up the app, click on ESPN. Who provides American Airlines in-flight television, but DirecTV blacked out.
Never mind.
The best part is we got on the flight and the Jets were ahead and we got off the flight and the Niners had won.
Yeah, dude. Come on now. I am not a Niner fan, but I like when AFC teams lose. So that's pretty cool.
Do you have anybody from the Niners on your fantasy team?
No. So here's the thing. 4 or 5 years ago, I I have the number one pick in my fantasy league. I picked Christian McCaffrey for the second year in a row. He's coming off of his injury. I had him the year before and he got injured and I was like, ah, crap. And then I had the number one pick again. I pick Christian McCaffrey and he gets injured again. And I made a promise to myself. I said, I will never pick Christian McCaffrey in fantasy ever again, even if I have number one and even if he's projected number one. I just won't do it. It's a principle now. It's a rule. Now, I didn't have number one this year again, but my buddy did, and he picked Christian McCaffrey, and I laughed.
And then guess what happens? He's already out injured.
Yeah, dude. He ain't playing.
He's out injured. Debo Samuel's out injured.
Yeah, that was funny. I told Melissa, Dwayne's wife, I told Melissa that Debo got injured the other day because I got a notification. He's like out for a couple weeks with a calf or something. And she was like, no way. This can't be happening. But they'll be fine.
These probably. Football players are too soft.
We'll see if Brock Purdy's worth the money.
We need to bring back bullying of football players.
Dude, watch a Charger game, baby. That's what's happening. That's literally what it is. Although I will say this. There was a couple sports analysts. They put the Chargers way up in the power rankings. I was like, bro, relax. I literally left a comment on someone's ranking. He's like a prominent sports guy. Colin Cowherd, if you know, you know.
I love watching him. I'm not even a sports guy.
Yeah, and he put the Chargers number three in the power rankings. And I literally left a comment on his Instagram. I said, bro, relax. From a Charger fan. Like, there's no way. Maybe number like 9 or 10 right now, but we haven't really played anyone real. Like, we played, I guess the Raiders are real now because they just beat the Ravens, but they're not like real, real. They're like, they play a tough game, but that was about it. And then we just smoked the Panthers, but that's whatever. But who knows, dude? We got defense looking tough, run game looking tough, offensive line looking tough. Justin Herbert doesn't even have to throw. Like, he hasn't thrown over 200 yards either game. But that's not because he's played bad. It's just they're not even asking him to play, really. He's just out there.
We're going to have to introduce a new segment on this show called Teach Dan Football.
Dude, I'll do it.
So
I'll teach football right now.
Explain to me real quick, and we can get ready to close after this.
Yeah.
Explain to me, like, the worst thing that could happen to you in fantasy football aside from an injury.
Well, aside from an injury, the worst thing would just be like they don't play well. I mean, I guess it would be like if you have like a wide receiver who just never gets targeted. So they're projected to, like, it'll tell you on fantasy football, like, this player is projected to get 16.8 points this week because they're projected to get like 7 catches, 90 yards, and a touchdown based on what they normally perform as. But what would be bad is if you start that player against a team and then that player just never gets the ball thrown to them, but like they're healthy, you know, yeah. That's not fun, I guess. Or if just the team that you're going against massively outperforms. Part of fantasy football is like you're going to have players who are missing a week cause they're injured or their whole team is not playing cause they're on a bye week. And you only have a finite amount of roster spots. So you have to kind of go on the waivers and look at all the available players, and you can just add players to your team, but you have to drop. And another part of it is like, so Christian McCaffrey is not playing. Nobody drafted the 49ers second string running back in fantasy football. However, right when it's announced that Christian McCaffrey might not play, it's kind of like a race in your whole league. Who's going to go pick that guy up? Because we know that he's going to play now and he's available. He's like for free or whatever. So there's a lot of strategy there, I guess, but you never really know. Like, I have a good fantasy team. My draft grades were like A+ in pretty much every league. And week one, I think I lost every week, except maybe one. So
we
never know.
My uncle's fantasy league just celebrated their 44th season, 43rd season.
That's nuts.
Yeah. I forgot football had even been around that long.
Fantasy football that long, that's nuts.
Yeah, he was doing fantasy football like when the internet was first becoming a thing.
Wow.
Yeah, absolutely cool. Absurd. Well, dude,
awesome.
This was not where we thought this conversation was going to go today, like at all.
Not at all.
And hey, it's still cool.
But we did it.
I was really stoked. I'm ready to see you tonight for the Amazing Race. We're going to have a freaking amazing time.
Yeah, dude, we'll see. So we're talking Amazing Race before it happens. Hopefully it goes well. No one's going to see this until after, obviously. So we could talk. We're going to have a dunk tank. We're going to, there's going to be a little kiddie pool with little baby Jesuses, and they got to go bob for baby Jesuses. But in the kiddie pool, instant mashed potatoes. How about that? There's also going to be an RV pool with a rope. That's nuts. And then what is there another disgusting one? There's a couple.
There's a few. There's the sock drink.
Oh, yeah, like chug a soda, except however you have to grab a teammate's sock and drink it through the sock.
Blech. Yeah.
Gross.
I mean, I'm doing the blindfolded traffic cone maze.
Yes.
So, and I still haven't found out if I'm supposed to build the maze or if I'm just running this thing.
Nah, dude, you won't have to build it, but you have authority to change it every round if you want or make it kind of crusty. So you're not building it, though.
Oh, thank God.
That should be built before. You're good.
Heck yeah.
But yeah, it's going to be a good time. We'll see what happens. We're praying for a lot of guests and a lot of people who are hungry to know the Lord. So hopefully that happens tonight.
Well, I'm loving it. I got to find a way to record this podcast from San Diego next week. And now that you have a working laptop, we will make this work and it's going to be good. It's so good to be back to the We Go Show. Thank you guys for tuning in again. This has been fun. We go.
Love y'all.
We go.